Okay, this talk is actually inspired by, sorry, not enough hands, by this little thingy. Just move it around and you can have a look at it. It's one of Larry's originals. And for years I've been wondering, what the hell was he thinking just doing this on it and then just sign it with his name and his stamp and everything? I didn't understand it. And there was some little text here and that said, actually, pardon the cocoon. Cocoon? Well, actually, this is not the way you spell it in English. So maybe that was the source of my confusion. Anyway, and this is about this. It's about Cocoon. So let's go back a little bit. If you look at Perl 5 from 2000, we have Perl 5.6 in 2000, we have 5.8 in 2002. That's only 2 years. That's 5 years for 5.10. That's 3 years for 5.12. But since then, we've had a yearly release of Perl 5. If you look at Perl 6, we've had the original camel heard this meeting, and I accidentally happened to be there as well. There was no intent on it beforehand, but I happened to be there, so it was very good. Then we had the apocalypses, the exegesis, and the synopsis. I actually practiced this. We had Parrot as a virtual machine for everybody. We had Pugs, and we have Rakudo on Parrot and Nietzsche on Mono.net. None of them actually were ready for production in any way, shape, or form. So you could actually consider the zeros, the cocooning years of Perl. It was busy with itself, it was redefining itself, and it was basically reinventing itself. So what is Perl? And I would say those years are now over. So getting back to our little thingy here, which is still somewhere around, I guess. I would say it's not going to be our normal decocooning of the camel. It's going to be something that will coexist for a long time. So it's not just the one leaving the other just right away. So what did Perl 5 do in the tens? Like I said, we have a new release every year. We had many optimizations and internal code cleanup. Thank you. We had a lot of Perl 6-like features in Perl 5. We've had Perl 6-like modules in Perl 5 on CPAN. And we had a monthly development release. That's even also very important to notice that every month there's a new version of Perl 5 that if you want to really stay ahead of things happening, you want to try. Yes, not many people know that, but there is a monthly development release for Perl 5. 5.21.0 is about to come out, I think, in next week. And as you may notice, 5.20 just came out. So make sure that you get it and use it and find out if your code is actually compatible or not. It should be, mostly. We have Perl 6 in the tens. We had the implementation of Nietzsche, which was very feature complete initially. It's now falling behind, mainly for the reason that the main developer is not developing it anymore. And we had the development of Not Quite Perl, which is like a Perl 6 to write Perl 6 in. Yes? I wouldn't say that he actually moved from Nietzsche to Rakudo because he only did little things on Perl 6 on Rakudo and hasn't done much in the past year. So in a way, he just stopped. We had the so-called 6 model, which is the meta model of Perl 6 objects written in NQP, which I would consider actually the third iteration of the third time that Perl 6 got implemented again. Very important. We now got MoreVM, which is a new virtual machine for Perl 6, which is like what Parrot should have been, but isn't. And we have now Rakudo running on the old Parrot. We have recruiter running on the JVM and on MorphVM. And we also have a monthly development release. No? Okay. So, coming back to this, will they continue to coexist, Perl 5 and Perl 6? I would say yes. But I think Perl 6 will become bigger and more important in the future. And it will be more future-proof than Perl 5. So what are the cool Perl 6 features in Perl 5? We have say, we have yada, yada, yada. We have state variables. We have defined OR, lexical subs, subroutine signatures. Anything that could be stolen from Perl 6 that does not involve typed information, types in general, is okay to use in Perl 5. So, if you look at this code in Perl 5, you can now say foo, which would be exactly the same as print foo with a new line. And guess what? This is how it looks in Perl 6. Is there any difference? No. Well, there's a subtle thing here. This is sort of orange, like be careful. And this is green, go ahead. Yes? None. You always have to say that. Backward compatibility. Somebody could have made a say subroutine that. Exactly. The yada, 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 the three period, the three dots. If you actually run this in Perl 5, it says unimplemented. But if you try to put that into a variable, you get a syntax error. So it's not completely yada, yada, yada yet. In Perl 5, you can actually do this as well. Perl 6, I mean, you get a different message, stub code executed rather than unimplemented. It's a thing in the wording. You can actually put this in a variable in Perl 6 and actually ask it what it is. It's a failure. And then if you actually want to show it, then actually the exception is thrown and you actually get the error message. So in Perl 6, you can actually have things blow up in your face later, which is very important if you want to do asynchronous programming. You don't want to have everything throw up at the same time immediately when it happens. State variables in Perl 5 look like this. Every time you call a subroutine, the first time you call it, it will be initialized to 10, and it will keep the value of the variable for each subsequent call. So if you do this for 0 to 9, we nicely get 11 to 20. And if we do this in Perl 6, it's exactly the same. It's just that I chosen here to use a different way of specifying 0 to 9. 0 to 10 minus 1, except the last one. That's what this little caret means. Don't do the last one. This will come back to you. The defined OR slash slash in Perl 5, if this is undefined, it will actually go to B, 42. If you do the normal OR, it would not make a difference. However, if A is 0, the defined OR will give you the 0 rather than the 42. And it's very important to make a difference between unspecified parameters to a subroutine and specifying 0 as a value to a subroutine. Normally, if you use this, 0 will have the same effect as undefined, which is generally not what you want. So, how does this look in Perl 6? Exactly the same. This is a new feature that I think has been in there since 5.18. It's called lexical subs in Perl 5. So you can actually specify a named subroutine inside a scope. If you call it inside the scope, it works. If you call it outside the scope, it doesn't know about it. Right, so it's actually the same as doing this. undefined subroutine. If you try to do this in PIL 6, you don't have to do the my because all subs are lexical anyway. It's the same, but there's a subtle difference here in PIL 6. The A here outside is actually a compile time error. PIL 6 realizes that you will never be able to call a subroutine, so it will actually warn at compile time already, which is very handy if you make typos in your program and you don't want to wait for a few minutes to actually get to the point when it calls a subroutine and it realizes that it can't call it. So this is actually the same then in PIL 6. If you try to call a subroutine and PIL 6 can determine at compile time that you can't call it, it will tell you so. This is very handy. The latest thing is subroutines. What was the question? Okay. There's subroutine signatures in PIL 5. So you can now specify basically the variable, and you can even have a hash for catching the name parameters that you give. So if you actually call this subroutine with these parameters, you will get this as the result. Could be also A1, B2, because the order in these don't really determine. And in PIL 5, this is basically syntactic sugar for using at underscore. So at underscore still exists in PIL 5, even if you're using signatures. So it's something that will make your life easier as a programmer, but it will not give you any performance improvements. If you compare this to PIL 6, in PIL 6 we can do the same thing here with the so-called slurpy hash. That's why you have the star here, it makes it a slurpy. And because a hash normally would be a single item object, and we don't want to do that in this case, so we're actually slurping everything else that we get in here. And you get the same thing here, except that the specification of showing the hash is a little bit different. Now, if you try to actually do this with the at underscore in PIL 6, it will actually say give you this error message at compile time. Signatures in PIL 6 indicate how your parameters are going to be processed. If you do not specify a signature, it will actually provide a signature that will create at underscore for you. So if you're using at underscore and throw this out, it works just like PIL 5, but you can't use them together. Right? So what are the problematic PIL 6 features in PIL 5? We have standard async promises that are event loop dependent. We have smart match that is actually now marked experimental again and is probably going to be deprecated. We have subroutine signatures, but they are limited and they're basically only synthetic sugar. So it basically goes to show that bolting on new stuff is always difficult when you do it later. So standard async in PIL 5, we have iThreads, so like everybody knows. They actually suffer from a very flawed implementation, like Madang actually talked about yesterday, I think. But there's no real alternative in PIL 5 for it. It's basically using the fork emulation that was created for running Perl on the Windows to emulate threads running under Unix, which, when you think about it, is completely crazy. I understand from Madang it's now officially discouraged in 5.20. Maybe we have a module on CPAN called forks.pm that actually uses fork to implement threads in PIL 6 on Unix. That may be helpful for you. It basically works, and I've heard good stories about people using it rather than using the standard threads modules. But still, I would say, if you're going to program threads yourself, it's always going to be very, very difficult. I would say almost superhuman. And then I think about Brian Kernighan's quote, Debugging is twice as hard as writing the code in the first place. Therefore, if you write the code as cleverly as possible, you are, by definition, not smart enough to debug it. And this is very, very true if you're programming threads. Promises in Perl 5 are very nice. They're basically asynchronicity for non-superhumans. You can get it as a CPU module on Perl 5. It needs an event loop. And usually you cannot have more than one event loop in your program, so you might get into trouble when you're trying to do that with generically with other modules. And a lot of cases, it's probably not actually really asynchronous. It just fakes it for you. We have smart match in Perl 5. Well, you need typing in variables and objects to make smart match work. This is something that the people of Perl 6 did not realize when the people of Perl 5 stole it. So this is a very good case of where Perl 6 actually learned from the mistakes of Perl 5 trying to implement Perl 6 features. We realize that now in Perl 6. Perl 5 will most likely never have typing. It's going to make such a basic change to the system that you cannot actually do that, and basically any access code will break. What we have now is really a source of confusion, because nobody really knows by heart what is going to happen with a smart match in certain situations. They really have to look it up and try it out. So it's been marked experimental again, and it will most likely be deprecated in the future. We have subroutine signatures, I just told you that, arrived in 5.20, syntactic sugar. I would say it's really nice to have anyway, because it's one of the last things that made Perl 5 different from many other languages. So it's very nice to have. To give an example of the true signatures in Perl 6, this is an example of accepting a name parameter. The colon dollar name creates a lexical dollar name in the subroutine, and this is the default value if you don't specify. So if I call it with just without parameters, it will say, hey you. If I give it a parameter here, it says, hey Paris. Now you might ask, what the heck is this? Well, if you do the fat comma, which also exists in Perl 6, and you ask what it is, this is a macro that actually describes, tell you what this is, what you're doing this on, it will tell you it's a pair. And the pair can be actually shown as a Perl thing as well, that is basically a key value pair. But there's another way of specifying that, and that's basically using colon key smaller than string greater than. Now this way of specifying words you will find everywhere in Perl 6. So this is something you will see a lot. So this again is a pair, so if you actually ask for the Perl representation of this, is actually the same as this. So that's just another way of specifying a fat comma. It's fewer characters. And the other thing that's very important about typing in Perl 6 is that you can actually have multi-subs and multi-methods. If you specify multi-A, this is actually short for multi-sub-A. And this signature tells it, call this one if you specify a number. Call this one if you specify a string. So if you call the same sub here with a number, it would say number 42. If you call it with a string, it would say string foo. This is also very important in Perl 6, where you can actually have a lot of different candidates for your subroutine available, and you can actually add them later if you want to as well, for your own objects, for instance. So, what does this typing mean for you? Well, if you say my $A is foo, and you say it, it just works, right? If you say, this is a number, and you try to put foo in it, it will say, sorry, can't do that. I expected a num, I got a string. Does not compute. Right? If you say, string, foo, it just works. So you might think, okay, now it's going to check types all the time if I specify this. Isn't that really a waste of CPU? Well, maybe, but it's at a very low level, done at a very low level. And you should realize that even if you do this, it's actually doing type checking, because my $A is actually my any $A, and any accepts anything. Well, almost anything, but it's very technical. So whatever you're doing, the type checking is already happening. So if it makes sense for you to do it, then please do it. This is something we call in Perl 6 gradual typing. You can use typing if it helps you. If you don't want to be bothered by it, then don't. So what are Perl 5 features in Perl 6? Well, actually at the moment we only have one. It's called use v5. And what is that? Well, use v5 is actually originally started by Tim Todi, aka Larry Wall. It's now maintained by Frogs, which is aka Tobias Leich. It's basically the idea of re-implementing Perl 5 the way that we implemented Perl 6. Perl 6 is implemented using a grammar. The grammar builds tree representations of your code in memory, and then creates executable code for that. V5 tries to do the same thing for Perl 5. So if the Perl 5 code you give it passes the grammar parsing, in the end you wind up with identical code to Perl 6, which means that you can call Perl 6 subroutines from Perl 5 and vice versa. This is very important. This is going to be very, very good. The only problem is no XS code. XS is not going to work in this situation. So you can only do this on pure Perl code. And it only passes 10% of the tests at the moment. There's actually a good reason why it's only 10%. Any code that one of the features that we still not have in V5, but we just recently got in V6, is labels. Labels and goto. There's a large part of the test suite that actually depends on skipping code, and skipping in Perl 5 is implemented actually as a goto internally with the label. So anything that like that will not pass yet. So this will increase. Very soon, very much. And it's most likely going to be part of the next Recudo Star distribution. So you can very easily try it for yourself and see how it works. So what is needed for Perl 6 adoption? I think a good introduction ebook, more modules, and better performance. The book. Well, the rumor has it that somebody who wrote a book about 2 years ago is writing it now again, but this is only rumored, so I can't substantiate that. But this should not stop you from writing your own, or just blog. Yes, or just blog about your experiences and let us know what you did, because we really like to know as a Perl 6 developers to actually know what's going on there. More modules and CPAN support. You can already upload CPAN 6, Perl 6 distributions to CPAN. You already can find Perl 6 distributions on CPAN. It's just not shown in all of the regular meta CPAN stuff yet, but the Perl 6 code can actually look them up on CPAN. We should be able to install them very soon with using Panda. Panda is basically the Perl 6 equivalent of CPAN client, and we're going to have an effort of porting CPAN modules later this year. For instance, at the, what, 50 minutes? Ah, I timed it as 40 minutes. That's for the reason. Okay, good. Better performance. MoreVM is now standalone. What does that mean? MoreVM doesn't need anything else to actually build on your system, which is very important. It's creeping towards Perl 5 for a various number of reasons. If you, for instance, start up Perl 5 and Moose and load Moose with some of the extensions, you get about the same startup time as Perl 6 using MoreVM. Not JVM, because that by itself already takes like 5 seconds to start or something. So don't do it there. We have a lot of things for code inspection for optimization built in. A lot of that is being used already. So that's why it's getting a lot faster. We actually have a Google Summer of Code project to develop JIT for more. And I'm happy to say that as of yesterday, we actually saw the first JITted code execution for MoreVM. It was still very, very simple, but it basically showed that the whole framework that we have actually works and that we can do this. So this is all very exciting. Personally, I think the combination of JIT code and use V5 maybe at some point would make a faster Perl 5 than Perl 5 using V5 and this. But we're not there yet, and I'm pretty sure everybody will know about it when we get there. So why would you use Perl 6 in production? Well, I would say saner implicit explicit multi-core programming, channels, promises, supplies. There should be fewer versioning, well, even no versioning issues with modules. The thing is that the use command in Perl 6 is lexical. And I'll give you an example of that. And of course, we have cool features, and cool features means happier programmers, and happier programmers in general mean more productive programmers. Well, that's my idea anyway. So let's look at this piece of code, which is actually Perl 6 code. Use test actually exports this OK subroutine. If you're doing testing, and you should, this should be familiar to you. However, if you put this use test inside the scope, it does not know about the OK outside of the scope. This is very important, because with use in Perl 6, you can also indicate which author of the module you want, which version of the module you want. And so basically, this means you can have multiple versions of the same module loaded at the same time in memory, provided they're not in the same scope. This is very important for sysadmins, because that means that they only have to provide all of the modules that are actually necessary, but they don't have to worry about upgrading as long as they keep the old modules available. If the code says, I want to use version 1.1 of this module, it will not break if you upgrade. Very important, I think. This is an example of actually the async processing that we have in Perl 6. How that may make sense for you already, right now. So take this very example here. This is actually short for 0 to caret 10. So this thing means 0 to 9. I'm going to have a random sleep, and I'm going to print the number that I got. Now, that's very easy. This takes about 5 seconds. It uses a certain amount of CPU, etc. If you want to make this async, it's very easy to do this in Perl 6. You basically put a start block around the code that you want to execute. The start basically starts up a thread and returns a promise by saying do. The for actually returns all the values that it gets, so we get a list of 10 promises. And the await function basically waits until all the promises are kept. If you do it like this, you see the order changes because it's now become random. But the wall clock time is like a fourth of the original, whereas the CPU is still the same. And this is an example of how you can very easily create faster code. Even though it may use more CPU, it may still be faster than other approaches that you do. This is another example. If you know Damien Conway's quantum superpositions module, this is called a junction. This puts a junction in $A, which means it's any of those values. It's 1, 2, or 3. If you actually ask it, are you equal to 1, it actually tells you, well, yes, no, no. Right? It's another junction. If you actually want a Boolean out of that, it's true, because any of them is true. Right? So this is a very easy way to say this has to be 1, 2, or 3. Now, this here basically gives a number between 0 and 99, for instance 71. This is another way of specifying this, but from a list. So any of these. So would this, if I pick a random number and this is 1 to 99, would this be true or not? Well, because it's in the same range, this would always be true. If I change this to 1,000, we have a chance of 1 in 10 to be true or false. Now, what's the trick here? The idea is that in the future, this is not happening yet, but it may soon now, because we have asynchronicity in Perl 6 now. This would automatically create separate threads to find out if you have a match. So this is a case of implicit asynchronicity that Perl 6 will provide. So, how can you try Perl 6? Well, if you are a user, it's a version of Rokudo that is with plenty of models to try. Actually, the next version will have V5. It's called Rokudo Star. That's where you can get it. If you consider yourself to be a tester, there's something called, there's a Rokudo equivalent of Perl Brew, which is called Rokudo Brew, that does everything for you. If you want to become a contributor, then you just create a directory, you git clone your stuff, go into the directory, create it, then wait for a few minutes, and you have your Perl 6 available. Right? So, where can you get support for Perl 6? I think the first line of support is actually the IRC channel on Freenode, Perl 6 channel. You got people there. There's a lot of examples that you can get on the Rosetta Code site. So if you want to compare Perl 6 code with Perl 5 code, there's very many examples. I think there are now more Perl 6 examples for the questions on Rosetta Code than there are for Perl 5. Jonathan Worthington, who's done a lot of work on Perl 6, actually has a large list of articles that you might want to look at. We have a whole set of blogs that people write. There's a specific article if you're coming from Perl 5. And, of course, if you really want to get into the nitty-gritty, there's the synopsis that you can have a look at. So, I guess that's how the camel is decocooning. I know it's very yawning, but yeah. Any questions?
In the beginning of your slides, you captured the failure. Don't you have to use the colon equal to not put it in sync context and have it fail immediately? When you capture a yada yada yada,
yeah,
do you not have, do you, can you, if you use just a simple equal, not a colon equal, Yeah. Will it not be a sync context and fail immediately?
No, if you make sure in the REPL that it's, which is the problem that you're probably referring to, generally if there's any code following it, if it's not the last line in your program, it will work. If it's the last line in your program, which is effectively, I think, what's happening in the REPL is the little thing that you, if you just say Perl 6, it will allow you to enter code and try things out that way. It provides what we call sync context, and that will automatically throw the exception. So that you might think that it doesn't work, but it actually does work. It's just not in that particular case that it doesn't work.
Thanks.
Everybody flabbergasted? There's, I think that's a question there.
I want to know something. Is there persist in production, in real production for business or something like that? Do you have examples?
I know several people that are working on Perl 6 are using it in production for whatever production they do. I would say generally, if you have something like a cron job that runs every 5 minutes and it runs for maybe 10 seconds at the moment, and you wouldn't mind it running now for 20 seconds, you can already switch to Perl 6. All those cases.
Is there interest in Perl 6 from outside of the Perl community? Are other people in the computing world watching it?
I think so. I think if you look at the number of contributors to Perl 6 at the moment, I would say between a third and a half of the people that contribute to Perl 6 at the moment do not have a Perl 5 background, which to me implies that people are watching it. I think there's one person that we'll hear later today that will actually tell some more about it.
Any other question?
No. Okay, then I would like to thank you for our white camel, and thank you for being here.
Thank you for being here.